Alright guys, so for this Friday I'm gonna do some work. I'm going to spend some time with pets, obviously. Tomorrow is a very special day. Mabuhay squad. Tomorrow is a special day because...
Hey guys, welcome to my daily vlogs. Please subscribe.
It's Labor Day here in the Philippines. Good morning, guys. Just woke up. Ah! It is a beautiful Saturday. It's the weekend. But yeah, it's Labor Day here in the Philippines. Labor Day is different from Labor Day in North America, where it's on in September, right? So it's a long weekend because usually people go to the beach at this time and like they spend weekends on the beach or vacationing somewhere here in the Philippines. But obviously because we are in lockdown, we are all vacationing here at home.
Good morning, doggies. Good morning, Sifes. And Sahara, did you sleep well?
Obviously, they love the sun. Gorgeous, gorgeous morning here in Mandaluyong City in Metro Manila.
Yeah.
Gorgeous sun. Weather is gonna be great today. It's gonna be a great Labor Day. By the way, guys, if you're new to the vlogs, welcome to the channel. My name is Mikey Bustos. Be sure to hit the like button if you enjoyed this vlog and hit the subscribe button. Join the Mabuhay Squad. We will be your daily dose of positive vibes online. Yes. Sorry, I don't have a shirt right now. I literally just got out of bed. I'm gonna put one on right now. All right, guys, I'm decent again. I have a shirt. All right, Cypher's coffee is coming. Trust me, guys, promise. I keep saying that, but it is. There's a lot of paperwork that needs to be done when releasing like a food product, which is a good thing because it means anything that gets released is like, it's been checked, it's been approved, all of that good stuff. It's for everybody's good, right, guys? So how was your sleep? Did you sleep well? I know I did. So yesterday's vlog was about, well, it was announcing that we're thinking of selling my place. And so many of you guys have wrote in. Wow. OMG, like my email is blowing up, guys. So many Mabuhay Squad are like inquiring, and not just here in the Philippines, like some of you guys abroad in the US, all of that. Even my dad messaged me last night. He's like, my friend in Chicago wants to know how much you're selling your place. It's crazy, but it's great. I mean, personally, I would love that a Mabuhay Squad lives here because I already feel a connection with you guys. You guys are, it's like we see each other every day, right? And just knowing that a Mabuhay Squad is living here somehow makes me feel better. It's like, ah, okay, someone good is gonna take care of this place. As weird as that is, I don't know, I'm just being weird. I guess whoever ends up moving here will value it and treasure it no matter what. But for some reason, I don't know, I feel like a Mabuhay Squad would be pretty cool living here, personally. Because then the Mabuhay Squad kind of knows the history of the place. You know what I mean? I don't know, it's just weird. So, another thing you guys were commenting in yesterday's vlog was, oh, I know what the shoot is. It's maybe a commercial for coffee, or maybe it's a commercial for another product. Guys, no, trust me, it's bigger than that. I can't tell you what it is. I have been teasing this fairly important shoot. By the way, I'm an actor and a comedian and a singer here in the Philippines. But I've been asked to be part of this shoot that is pretty major. It's probably the biggest shoot, well, certainly that I've done this year, and probably last year too. It's pretty major. And it's not just here on YouTube. Actually, I do hope it gets uploaded to YouTube, but I don't want to say what it is because, you know, I also don't want to jinx it. Like, it's official, but RJ's like, just announce when it's ready to launch. And I agree, because that's what I learned on the Kardashians. Don't announce till you're ready to launch. So anyways, I've just been teasing it. But yeah, this big shoot is happening. Oh my gosh, some of it's happening tomorrow. We might shoot some more on another day. I actually have a meeting this morning with a team where I can't say. Anyways, guys, trust me. Remember this day. And then when we make the final announcement, you'll understand everything. Cheers. Here's some Cypher coffee. Ah, love that taste. All right, guys, so if you're following me on other social media platforms, I just posted a video of my Canadian Idol audition from 18 years ago. Guys, it's been 18 years this month. So if you haven't seen it yet, here it is. Check it out.
Say hello to Mikey Bustos. Inside my mind, and in my dreams I've kissed your lips a thousand times. I sometimes see you pass outside my door. Hello, is it me you're looking for? 'Cause I wonder where you are, and I wonder what you do. Are you somewhere feeling lonely, or is someone loving you? Tell me how to win.
Oh,
your
beautiful, bro.
Yes, I do not.
That's what I'm talking about, man. Holy smokes. So your tone is unbelievable. Woo!
Mikey, man.
Holy smokes.
Mikey.
I'm vibrating.
Okay,
up.
Come here, man. You're amazing.
You. Your tone is unbelievable.
You're amazing.
Thank you.
God. You're amazing, pal.
Thank you.
Mikey, my
beautiful.
God,
oh my
man.
God. Beautiful. Beautiful.
Unbelievable. Mikey can stand in a room and sing without music.
What a tone.
That means so much to me. Oh,
you're unbelievably great.
I can't believe what's going on.
Tell us how you're feeling.
You don't understand. My dream is to break the Asian barrier in the music industry in North America, and this just got me so much closer. Mwah! Canadian Idol, I love you. Thank you.
Crazy, right? I was such a little kid back then. Well, I was 21 years old. And I can't believe it's been 18 years. Oh my gosh, that feels like a lifetime ago. But it just was a crazy experience, guys. I've been like thinking back and trying to remember and reminisce. Well, I'm not trying. I do remember what life was like back then. Obviously, I was still living in Canada. At the time, as a young adult, I had just gotten over a breakup, or I was in the middle of a breakup with an ex-girlfriend at the time, and it was a very tumultuous time, like socially and romantically for me in those days. But yeah, Canadian Idol kind of just came right on time, I suppose. I remember my high school friend Lawrence, who you guys have met in the vlogs in previous seasons. I remember him, he was driving me. We were going to a restaurant or something, and he was like, so yeah, Canadian Idol is coming to town. And you know, I had heard of Idol, the Idol franchise, because American Idol had just finished their second season. Ruben Studdard, for those of you in the US, he had just been crowned as Idol. And that's when they had announced that it's coming to Canada. So we're like, OMG, like, wow. So yeah, you know, I had heard about it. However, I was kind of lukewarm on the idea because there was another reality singing competition that had come to Canada a couple months prior. And it was called Pop Stars, which also happened in the US, right? That's where Eden's Crush was formed. Pop Stars, do you guys remember this? From like early 2000s, do you remember? And in Eden's Crush, that's where Nicole Scherzinger, who later became part of Pussycat Dolls, who later went solo, had her first break on that show, Pop Stars. So I totally looked forward to that. I auditioned, I fell in line. I was like, yes, you know, like my voice will shine through. Of course, I didn't dress up really for that. I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna let my talent shine through. So I lined up and I wore this like really ugly, like striped shirt. And I didn't even make it past the first cut, guys. Like after a whole day of lining up and looking forward to it, it broke my heart. So, you know, like when I had heard that Canadian Idol was coming to town, I was just like, I will try out for it, but I won't look forward to, you know, making it in the competition. So I treated at the time, Canadian Idol, like a good opportunity to network. So my plan was this. I created a CD and it was so homemade, guys. It was of a song that I wrote along with Lawrence Lam, my high school friend, who is really great at piano. So he recorded the piano part. I had written the song and it was called Perfect Man. And that was my demo. I recorded it with this 8-track digital recorder in my mom's living room. And I recorded it and then it can press a CD. You stick in a blank CD and it records. And so I printed maybe like 20 or 30 of these CDs and it was my demo. So my plan was to go to Canadian Idol and hand out my demo to like talent agents. Hopefully I could hand it to people in the industry, like possibly if ever I made it to the celebrity judges, I would hand my demo to them. Because when I tried out for pop stars, the lines were frequented by all of these talent agents, right? Like, cause it's a great big networking thing for like the music industry and, you know, like aspiring singers like myself. So that's what I treated Canadian Idol like. Oh guys, I also forgot to say that my state of mind at this time of my life. So you gotta understand, I lived and breathed music. Like I, in my heart, wanted to be a professional singer so badly. It started in high school, proceeded through high school, into university where I finally decided, screw university, I want to be a singer. Like it was that. I had no other choice. I had burned all bridges. I was going to be a singer. Like this was, singing was my life. If Canadian Idol didn't work out, I was gonna do something else that would like allow me to feel like I was still holding on to the dream of singing. Like that's how bad it was. Like morning to night, thinking about singing, practicing and practicing and practicing and practicing. That's important because going into Canadian Idol, I really wanted it badly, but I was also managing my expectations so I wouldn't get hurt. You know what I mean? When you want something so bad, it's like you don't wanna get hurt if you don't get it. So I was also mentally preparing for rejection in a strange way. Does that make sense? I wanted it, but I was prepared not to have it. So I remember I went to my friend Mike's house. He's this Canadian, he was my best friend at the time, and Angela. I had nothing to wear, but I had learned from the first time trying out at Pop Stars that I should look like a star, right? And I had no fashion sense back then. I didn't have nice clothes. So I was like, Mike, do you mind if I borrow your Rockaware velour tracksuit? Guys, Rockaware, do you remember that? That was like Jay-Z's clothing line at the time. And mind you, back in those days, it was expensive generally for like the average person. I think it was like maybe 40 or 50 bucks for the full piece velour velvet tracksuit. Mike was like, yeah, you could borrow it. So I'm like, yay. So I put it on. I had a few beers at Mike's place and they're like, good luck. And I'm like, yay, thanks. And I went in line. Literally in my velour tracksuit. And I had blue contacts at the time, earrings, shaved head. Like I basically tried my best to look different. But like this was my style back in those days. I had earrings, I had a shaved head. I just needed something to enhance my look, right? I loved wearing colored contacts. So then yeah, I fell in line the day before. People were saying that there were lineups 3 days before. So Toronto, right? In case you don't know, it's like the biggest city in all of Canada. And it was the last stop for the whole Canadian Idol competition. So it was basically the Hollywood of Canada. So people were lining up, guys, like 3 days ahead of the audition date. So I was like, oh man. And like news coverage, people were covering it on the news. Lineups were so long. And my plan was not to line up like 3 days ahead of time because, you know, people would get sick. Like you would be out in the cold at night and like under the heat during the day. And luckily I didn't, because turns out people did get sick over the 3 days of lineup. So I lined up the day before auditions. I was towards the end. And a lot of people still lined up after me. Slept over, overnight on the street, guys, with my backpack and like my sleeping bag, because you're not allowed to pitch tents. So slept overnight, made friends in line, woke up early in the morning. It must have been 3 or 4 a.m. And guys, this lineup was basically a singing rave. Everybody was singing non-stop. Amazing Grace, I heard maybe like a million times in like 52-part harmony. It was crazy. Amazing experience, guys. People handing out cards, people going through the line like, hey, what's your name? You know, can I hear your voice? And it was just really an amazing experience. That first day was just incredible. So what people don't know is your first round of audition is not for celebrity judges. You have to pass 3 rounds before you make it to celebrity judges on TV. So finally, it's like the next day, it was hot. We lined up like cows. Honestly, like in these lines, like which wound around like the longest roller coaster lineup ever. And then I finally got up to the tent. There must have been like 20 different auditioners, and we each went up to the auditioner. She's like, sing. I sang, I can show you the world. That was my audition song. And she was like, okay, that's it, done, you made it. I was like, what, that's it? You only sing for like 5 seconds and then they allow you to go to the next round. She's like, come back 5 a.m. tomorrow, same place. And we're like, oh my gosh, yay, I made it past the first cut. So I went home, I'm like, mommy, I made it past the first cut. Yay, I have to get back to audition tomorrow. So I did. And then all I remember is the next round, right? Still super long lineup, guys. They did it in rounds of 10. So imagine there's like a quiet room. We all shuffle into this room, 10 of us, with our number on our stomach. And we each have to step forward and sing for like 10 seconds this time. So we step forward. It was my turn. I'm like, oh my gosh. It's one auditioner. And I'm like, I can show you the world, shining, shimmering, splendid. Till, and she's like, okay, stop. And then we step back, and then she was like, number 3 and 4, step forward. It was like that kind of thing. So I stepped forward, and I don't think anyone else stepped forward in my line. And she's like, back line, go home, thank you for auditioning. You stay here, you're on to the next round. So I was like, oh my God, I like died. I'm like, thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So guys, after you pass the second round on that same day, you go upstairs to some other room where you audition for the executive producer of the show. Oh my gosh, this was like crazy, crazy, crazy pressure. I called home, I'm like, mommy, I made it past the second cut. I'm now auditioning for the executive producer. She's like, okay, good luck, we're praying. So I walk in, it's this man with a beard, right? His name was John Brunton, right? He had this like, this little cap, and he's just sitting there in front of a desk, and he's like, okay, sing. So I'm like, I can show you the world. And then after he was like, okay, what else can you sing? And I'm like, oh, I can sing Mariah Carey. He's like, oh, he's like, and so I'm like, oh my God, what Mariah Carey? I like blanked out. I'm like, there's a hero. And then he stopped me. He's like, okay, can you sing Motown? I'm like, Motown? Yeah. Put your head on my shoulder. And he's like, okay, can you sing Rock? I'm like, yeah. I don't wanna close my eyes. I don't wanna fall asleep, cause I miss you, babe. He's like, okay, can you sing a ballad? I'm like, oh my God. And he was making me sing all of these different genres. So I was like, OMG. Afterwards, he was like, you know, he kind of breathed, right? So I'm like, oh my God, I'm not gonna make it, guys. This was the end. This was the end of my Canadian Idol journey. I could feel it. He's like, you know, I am not exactly feeling your style. He's like, you really need to be more versatile, you know, like that. Because back then, I don't know if you guys watch Canadian Idol or American Idol, every week it's a different genre, right? So he's like, you know, you really should work on your versatility. And he's like, but I'm putting you through. Oh my God, when I heard those words, the blood left my body. I was like in heaven. I cried. I dropped to my knees and I was like, oh my gosh, thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. He's like, take no prisoners, right? So I made it. I went home and they scheduled the next round was for celebrity judges, guys. This was for TV. This was for the golden ticket, right? Now, here's the thing. I was happy to make it this far, beyond my wildest dreams. However, the catch to it was they also forward bad acts. Like people who aren't good singers, because you know, in the later seasons of Idol, they stopped this, the whole making fun of bad singers. But back in my day, they would forward the bad singers because it was part of the entertainment, right? The bad auditions. So this is how the bad auditions make it on TV and they make it to the celebrity judging, because if you're really bad, they will forward you. They'll be like, yeah, you're great. Make sure to go all out for the celebrity judges, right? It was like that. So I had no idea if I had made it to celebrity judges because my singing voice was bad. My God. So finally, I'm lined up. My dad came with me for moral support, right? The celebrity judges were there. I was so nervous, guys. I can't even begin to tell you. But I went up and I walked into this huge room. And as you saw, I stood in front of the judges. And actually, it didn't show on TV, but my first song was, I can show you the world. I sang that because it was my like most comfortable song at the time. And then they're like, okay, can you sing something else? So I'm like, oh yeah, sure, what do you want to hear? And they're like, can you sing Hello by Lionel Richie? Because that was one of the songs that I had sang for the executive producer the round before. And so he must have annotated it in our report card or whatever. So I did, I sang that. And that is what made it on TV. And then obviously the judges reacted. When I saw Sass Jordan going like this while I was singing, I was sure that I was gonna be torn apart on television. And they make you sign this waiver so they can edit your audition any way they want. So I was at the mercy of the show, really. Cause like, if they made me look, you know, like a bad singer, that could affect me and be on record forever, right? So when I saw Sass Jordan reacting the first time while I was singing the song, I was certain that they were going to insult me. But when they, like, to my surprise, liked my performance, that was it. It just, a dream come true. I dropped to my knees, as you saw. Kissed the golden ticket. Everything was a dream. I had made the top 42, which was boot camp. And yeah, it was the day that I realized that dreams come true. You know what I mean? Like the stars were aligned that day. Oh, and maybe one day I'll create another vlog on the rest of the experience, because that really is a whole other story. But that year, in short, I ended up placing 8th in the competition. And it really changed my life, and I'm just so grateful for it. And in the comments of some of you today, after posting the video up, you're like, yeah, I'm from Canada, I remember voting for you. Thank you guys so much for voting for me. I appreciate it a lot. It really changed my life. But anyways, thanks for listening to my story. My Canadian Idol audition story. And if you out there are listening and you have a dream, just know that dreams do come true. You just have to like keep pushing and wait for your time to shine, for that one opportunity. You know, it's crazy. This Canadian Idol experience literally made things for me go from 0 to 100. Like it was overnight fame. I remember when this audition aired on nationwide TV in Canada, which by the way was on my birthday. I went to the mall and like this guy randomly was walking. He's like, hey Mikey, great audition. I was like, like a random stranger. And it was then that I knew that like life changed forever. So you just never know, guys, when your big break will come. So keep hoping and keep working on getting better on your craft. Whatever your dream is, keep working towards that dream. Just one day your opportunity will pop up. Okay guys, positive affirmation for Saturday, April the 31st. Oh, There is no 31st. It's May 1st. It's gonna be May. All right. Love guides my every decision. The more I love myself, the more life loves me. And the more I accept the love I deserve, the more wonderful my life gets. Ooh, love that. This is a wonderful day. I choose to make it so. There you go, guys. Hope you enjoy today's positive affirmation. Ooh, guys. Okay, look. Turns out we got another package. I love these surprise packages. Ooh, and it looks really, really cool. Mabuhay squad. Check out what just arrived.